So another question that frequently is asked of us is how it is that two horses that are loudly patterned, as this slide shows, could end up producing a foal with very little white patterning, just perhaps a few white flecks on the rump. And in order to explain this, we should review a little bit about what we already know. We know from looking at the inheritance of LP that a horse that's spotted is what we call heterozygous for the LP mutation. That means it has an equal chance of passing on, in the case of the stallion, a sperm that contains the LP mutation, as it does a sperm that does not. That's symbolized by the dark sperm on the right and the small, the lowercase LP below it. The same is true of the mare. She has an equal chance of passing on an egg to the foal that contains LP or an egg that does not. So when we look at what we know and we see that it's possible for a foal to inherit one, two, or no copies of LP, that's part of the answer. However, because this foal has very little white patterning and its parents have a lot, know that there is a great range of quote patterning from a horse that's almost white down to a foal that has very, very little or no white patterning, even though it shows all LP traits.
And the reason that we see this variation is because there's more than one gene involved. So in addition to the main gene, LP, leopard complex, that controls whether a horse will be spotted or not, there are other genes that control how much white patterning is visible on the horse. And we call those other genes modifier genes. So in other words, more than one gene is at work. So LP is the essential gene, the essential ingredient that causes Appaloosa spotting as well as those associated associated traits like striped hooves, mottling, and varnish progressive roaning. And then there are other genes that modify the effect of LP that then control the amount of white patterning and the variation that we see from a horse that has white almost all over its entire body, all the way down to a horse that has just a few white flecks on the rump. So these genes that interact with LP and control the amount of patterning we call pattern genes, or PATN for short. And through our research, we have identified one gene that appears to have a large effect. And breeders may have said for years, it takes a leopard to make a leopard. Well, this gene that causes the leopard size version of white patterning is called PATN1 because it's the first pattern modifier gene that we have started to investigate. And PATN1, similar to LP, comes in two forms, a dominant form that is symbolized by all capital letters and a recessive form that is symbolized by all lowercase letters. Well, this gene behaves in a dominant fashion. And so what that means is that a horse only has to inherit one copy of the dominant form of the gene in order to display the large amount of white patterning. Now, it's important to note here that we mapped the LP gene to horse chromosome 1, but PATN1 maps to a different chromosome. So that's something to keep in mind, and we'll come back to that later. So PATN1 is a dominant gene, and unlike LP that was incomplete dominant, where we had three different possible phenotypes, PATN1 is completely dominant. So there are two potential phenotypes. If you inherit one dominant copy or two dominant copies of this gene, you will display a large amount of white patterning, as long as you have inherited at least one copy of LP. If you do not inherit any copies of the dominant version, in other words, you inherit both recessive versions of this PATN1 gene, and you have inherited LP, you will only display a minimal amount of white patterning.
Now, for someone in the field who is observing Appaloosas, it's nice to be able to try and identify those horses that are most likely to be carrying this modifier. And though there is not yet a DNA test for PATN1, we do have a pretty good idea of what these horses look like. The range of patterning is shown as these diagrams display, roughly between 60 and 100% of the horse being white patterned at birth. Now, most are around the middle of that range, as the purple underline shows in the second of the two pattern continua. And that's just an average that that tends to come out when we look at large groups of horses that have PATN1. And as you can see, the range of white is the same for heterozygous horses for LP and those that are homozygous for LP. So that doesn't seem to change the amount of white. What's important is the presence or absence of PATN1 itself. Now, when we compare the appearance of those horses to horses that have not inherited any dominant copies of PATN1, we see a much lower average level. In fact, most horses are born with a very small blanket, and that would be to the right-hand end of this pattern continua for both homozygous and heterozygous horses. That is a very small blanket that just covers the rump, around 20% of the animal being patterned at birth. And occasionally you will see horses at the higher end of the spectrum. This, we believe, is due to the presence of other small effect PATN modifiers that we have not investigated at this time. So now we're back to the question of how is it possible that two horses, leopards, with very large amounts of white patterning could create a foal that, although it's inherited LP, shows very little or no white patterning. Well, we know that some leopards are only going to have one copy of PATN1. We won't be able to tell by looking at them, as Rebecca has mentioned, and so we can't distinguish them from horses that have two copies of PATN1. However, we can investigate their pedigree. That's one way at this time that we could determine the possible progeny that a horse might produce.
Leopards and fuchs spots have two potential genotypes for PATN1. So remember, leopards have inherited one dominant version of the LP gene, where fuchs spots have inherited two dominant versions of the LP gene, and that gene resides on horse chromosome 1. But then both of those horses can inherit either one or two copies of the dominant version of PATN1, which is on a different chromosome. And so you can have individuals like in the top pictures that represent a fuchs spot and a leopard that are heterozygous for PATN1, only having one copy. But then you can see in the bottom, both a leopard and a fuchs spot can also be homozygous for PATN1, and we can't tell by phenotype alone. The other thing that's really important to keep in mind is that all three Appaloosa genotypes can inherit PATN1. So you can be homozygous for LP, like in the bottom picture, and if you're homozygous for LP and you're a fuchs spot, then we know that you have at least one copy of PATN1. You can be heterozygous for LP, like the leopard in the middle of the diagram, so that we know that you inherit one dominant copy of LP, as well as at least one copy of the dominant version of PATN1. But a horse can also be a true solid, homozygous recessive, not inheriting a dominant form of LP, not displaying an Appaloosa phenotype, not displaying any of those characteristics. But this horse, too, could have inherited a dominant copy of PATN1. Because remember, both of those genes are on two separate chromosomes. And by looking at this horse, this true solid horse, we're not able to tell whether or not PATN1 is present, because LP in its dominant form must be present in order to identify PATN1. So then back to our question. How can two loudly marked horses produce a horse that's minimally marked? Well, if we assume that both sire and dam are heterozygous for PATN1, we know that the sire can contribute either a dominant version of PATN1, which is represented by the white sperm, or he could contribute the recessive version, which is represented by the black sperm. And the same is true of the dam. By looking at this little guy here, what we know is that he has inherited both the black sperm and the black egg, and that this horse has LP, but does not have a dominant copy of PATN1.
Okay, so now we can answer the question. If we cross two horses that only each have one copy of PATN1, it is possible for them to produce a foal like the one in the last diagram that doesn't have a very loud coat pattern at all, unlike its parents. So just to take this a little further, let's look at all those possible outcomes together from that cross. Here we are crossing a heterozygous for PATN1 stallion with a heterozygous for PATN1 mare. The possible outcomes are as follows. 25% of the time, you're likely to get a foal that has inherited the dominant copy of PATN1 that the stallion has and the mare has. So that foal will be actually homozygous for PATN1. But 50% of the time, this sort of cross is going to create a foal that's just like the parents. It's going to inherit a dominant copy from one and a recessive copy from the other. So that's the most likely outcome. Then again, there is that chance, 25% of the time, that the foal will inherit the recessive form of PATN1 from both parents and thus be like the little fellow on the last slide, maybe even with no coat pattern at all, even though it's inherited LP. So looking again at how this can produce that, we can track this event. We can see that the recessive form of this gene can be inherited from both parents, and that's how a foal like this is produced. Now, just to go a little bit further with this, we should talk about the inheritance of LP at the same time. Now, as Rebecca has already made clear, LP and PATN1 are inherited independently of each other because they exist on two different chromosomes. They have the inheritance of one being separate from the inheritance of the other. And how we track that with this particular diagram is simply to say that you have an opportunity for two different LP genotypes to occur in each case. So in the box to the upper left, we see that for those foals that are born, as we had recently looked at in the last diagram, for those foals that are born inheriting a dominant copy of PATN1 from both parents, they have an equal chance of being either homozygous or heterozygous for LP. Okay, that's why there's one of each kind on that little block. Now to the right, in the case that happens most of the time, where the foal inherits one copy of PATN1 from one parent and the recessive form from the other, these two have a 50-50 chance of being either inheriting two copies of LP or only one. So we can see in this block, there's an equal chance of the foal inheriting one or two copies of LP from the parents, while at the same time being only heterozygous for PATN1. This is the most common outcome, as we previously stated. Finally, there is a 25% chance that the foal will not inherit PATN1 at all. Now, this is important to consider because, as Rebecca stated earlier, if the foal does not inherit LP, we can't tell by looking at it whether PATN1 has been inherited or not, because LP needs to be present in order for that coat pattern modifier to be activated to make a pattern on the horse. So all we can say about this last block is that in the case where PATN1 has not been inherited, for those foals that do inherit LP, we'll be able to tell. That's the left hand of these two dark horses. Imagine that one with characteristics and you get the idea. On the right is a mystery horse, which we know statistically has this 25% chance of having not inherited PATN1, but that we won't be able to tell just by looking.